Paleoclimatologist Jack Hall is giving a speech at the annual United Nations Global Warming Conference in New Delhi as the film opens. He informs the delegates that a polar disaster is imminent and will turn the entire planet into ice. When some of the delegates ask how much time is left, Jack responds that it may take decades, but their grandchildren will suffer the repercussions if the use of fossil fuels isn't reduced. Following the meeting, Jack encounters Terry Rapson from the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, with whom he strikes up a conversation about their respective research. It begins to snow severely while they talk, suggesting that climate change has already started. Strange weather patterns affect several regions of the planet throughout the ensuing few weeks. Massive hailstone chunks begin to fall from the sky in Japan, killing a number of people. These hailstones are the biggest ones ever recorded in human history. The computers at Terry Rapson's monitoring station in Scotland show that the ocean is seeing significant temperature reductions in some areas. The communication signals that were set there have immediately frozen because the drops are so unexpected and enigmatic. Astronauts on board the International Space Station observe massive storms developing elsewhere in the Earth's troposphere. The following scene is set in Washington, D.C., when Jack is seen sending off his son Sam at the airport. Sam, a brilliant student, has been given the opportunity to compete in a decathlon in New York. Despite the fact that Jack has always been absent from his life owing to his hectic work schedule, Sam seems to be upset with him despite the fact that Jack is a well-known man. However, he promises Sam that he will have plenty of time for his family after retiring. When Sam and his closest friends Laura and Brian eventually make it to New York, they witness a sizable flock of birds moving in a westward direction, as if fleeing from something. Terry phones Jack from his observation post in the interim to share his findings. According to him, they are swiftly nearing the polar catastrophe and do not have enough time to flee. Terry responds that something like hasn't occurred in the last 10,000 years when Jack asks if it's harmful. Then, we are escorted to a California weather monitoring station where a technician is having fun with his girlfriend. Just then, a man in despair calls him and informs him that hail is raining down in Los Angeles. The technician switches on the television after hearing this and is shocked to learn that portions of LA have been devastated by hailstones the size of golf balls. He phones his supervisor right away and requests that he issue a tornado warning for the state of California, but it is already too late. A number of enormous tornadoes quickly circle the city and obliterate everything in their path. The Office of Global Change in Washington, D.C. hosts an emergence meeting as a result. One of the attendees suggests that something is awry by bringing up past disastrous weather events that have occurred in other parts of the world. Just then, Jack, who is also present, informs the gathering that the North Atlantic currents are to blame for everything. The polar ice is melting quickly due to global warming, which in turn is causing the currents. He also said that this is just the beginning and that the weather will worsen for a few days. In the following scene, Jack meets with the vice president to try and convince him of the urgency of the problem. He warns that the Arctic blast could occur at any time, necessitating a widespread evacuation of the northern states. The VP, on the other hand, dismisses him and leaves. Three helicopters are dispatched to the Royal Palace to pick up the Queen because it is snowing heavily elsewhere in the UK. They do, however, travel through the storm's eye, which causes their instruments to abruptly freeze. The helicopter blades quickly quit functioning as well, and all three of the helicopters plummet to the earth. The one pilot who survives the crash is instantly frozen to death as he opens the door. Sam and his buddies attempt to return to DC from Manhattan, but the heavy rain has halted all transportation services. The group walks to the streets in a desperate attempt to leave the city but finds it in complete disarray. A gigantic wave suddenly materializes and starts to wash the area just then. The Statue of Liberty and other skyscrapers are completely covered, as if they were nothing. Sam and his crew hurry to the National Library Hall for safety as they spot the approaching danger. Thousands of unfortunate people unfortunately perish in the floods. Later, Terry phones Jack and tells him that the helicopters were brought down by the icy air above Europe. Jack is concerned by this, and after doing some study, he learns that the storm is moving faster than usual toward the US. In actuality, the world will ice over in just 48 hours. He then checks the weather forecast, which indicates that three enormous weather systems are developing in various parts of the Earth. The polar state has already started in Europe, and they are growing larger by the day. Sam is frantically looking for a phone in the library because there is no mobile phone reception there. After some while, he makes his way down to a lower level where he discovers a phone that is almost completely submerged in water. He swims there in an effort to phone his parents, which he does successfully. When Jack discovers that his son is alive, he begins giving him instructions. Sam is instructed to stay inside and wait for the storm to pass. He will instantly freeze to death if he goes outside. Sam becomes concerned when he hears this, but Jack reassures him by promising to come to his aid shortly. Everyone in the library hears a strange noise coming from outside the following morning as they are gathering clothing and food. They are astonished to see a cargo ship cruising through the area when they peep through the window. Jack is tasked with presenting the condition of the situation to the head of state, who is meeting somewhere in Washington, D.C. He mentions that the worst is still to come before even starting, instilling anxiety in everyone. Then he advises that all citizens of the southern states be promptly evacuated and relocated to Mexico. The vice president rejects the proposal yet again, stating that such a large-scale evacuation is not feasible. He further inquires as to what will befall the inhabitants of the north, to which Jack responds that it is already too late for them. They will instantly freeze to death if they leave their houses. The best they can do is wait for the storm to pass by while remaining inside their homes. Unexpectedly, the president follows Jack's recommendation and asks the National Guard to evacuate the rest of the populace to the south. Individuals at the New York Library observe a group of people strolling over a frozen field and assume they are traveling to a warmer region. They also make the decision to go outside before the snow becomes worse. Sam tries to let everyone know that it's a death mission because he is aware of the impending danger, but he is entirely disregarded. Everyone eventually exits the library with the exception of Sam's gang and a small number of other individuals. Along with his friends and co-workers Frank and Jason, Jack begins his journey to New York. The three are familiar with the conditions because they frequently travel to the north for study. Sam and his companions return to the library and search the entire establishment for food, coming across several vending machines. Additionally, they collect some books to burn in the fireplace. A blockage forces Jack and his team to continue their mission on foot in another location as they are traversing the deep snow. They do a few hours of diligent walking, but when they get to the top of a weak building, Frank breaks the glass and falls in. The two pals are supporting him while he is being held up by the lifeline when the glass suddenly begins to break. He must therefore cut his lifeline and make the ultimate sacrifice so that his buddies can carry out their goal. Laura suddenly develops a fever while in the library and loses consciousness. She has a wound on her leg, which may have contributed to her blood poisoning, and the gang begins investigating the cause out of concern. The group's only female doctor advises that Laura requires an immediate dose of penicillin or else she will need to have her leg amputated. Sam makes the desperate decision to enter the approaching cargo ship in the hopes that it will have some medicine in order to save his comrade. As he prepares to go, Brian and another man named JD also make the decision to go with him. The vice president learns that the president was involved in an accident and passed away while being evacuated in the scene that follows, where he is now working out of a military camp. The researchers also learned that the storm's eye has changed its route to head toward New York City, which only makes problems worse. In another location, Jack and Jason are making their way slowly to their destination when, regrettably, Jason passes out from exhaustion. Jack feels compelled to carry his pal as a result. The trio finally departs from the library and walks to the cargo ship. But as they proceed, a pack of ravenous wolves who have escaped from the adjacent zoo pick up on their scent. In the kitchen of the cargo ship, Sam, Brain, and JD discover some penicillin. The wolf pack suddenly attacks them as they are searching the area for further supplies. Sam and Brian succeed in leaving the room and moving to another one, but JD is badly bit. Nevertheless, they are able to protect him from the ravenous animals. Sam glances outside and notices the sky clearing while the three discuss various ways to get out of the predicament. He suddenly realizes that they are running out of time as the storm's eye draws closer to them. As a result, he risks his life by going outside to try to draw the wolves away from the kitchen. Then, he dashes through the sunken ship, barely avoiding the wolves. After some time, he catches up with his friends, but JD is now unable to stand. As a result, Sam and Brian drag their friend to the library on a sledge. On the other hand, Jack also spots the eye speeding at him as he is carrying Jason through the deep snow. He doesn't waste any time looking for residences in the snow. Thankfully, he discovers an accessible vent and drops Jason inside before entering himself. As soon as he shuts the door, a frost attack occurs, freezing everything in its path. Additionally, the boys arrive at the library barely in time, narrowly escaping death. The only thing that can protect them from freezing to death is the fire, so they rush to keep it going. Jack also makes a valiant effort to start a fire and is successful in doing so using an open stove. Jason eventually wakes up and discovers that the area has been completely coated in ice. Jack intends to carry out his job once the storm's eye has passed. Jason tries to convince Jack that the situation is still hazardous outside, but Jack insists that there is not enough time left. The two spend that evening talking about the future of humanity while they sleep in a tent. Jack points out that although humans have frequently survived cold ages, they risk going extinct in this one if they are not careful. After several weeks of terrible weather, the International Space Station finally notices some encouraging indicators. As they finally sight land after several weeks, they observe that the storm is weakening in Europe. Jack exits the tent at the same time and notices that the sky has become clear. Likewise, the sun has emerged. The frozen Statue of Liberty and other ships that have sunk into the ice are discovered after the two have been walking for some time. After days of severe pain and suffering, they have arrived in Manhattan. However, they are shocked to discover that the library has been totally consumed by ice when they use a GPS to locate it precisely. The two get ready to go because they have no more hope, but just then they spot a little gap in the snow. Jason quickly follows Jack as he quickly enters the library through the doorway. The two start hunting for Sam at that point, and fortunately they eventually discover him. It turns out that the fire is the reason Sam and his group are still alive. After weeks of being apart, the father and son pair finally meet with this, in the ominous weather. When the new president is notified that there are survivors in New York, the action then cuts to Mexico. He is excited by the news and declares live on television that he would launch a massive rescue effort to bring back anyone who is missing in the northern regions. When the helicopters arrive in Manhattan for the film's climactic sequence, some persons are discovered to be alive. As they wait to be saved, they have congregated on the rooftops. When Jack and his gang are ultimately carried to the south, the helicopters also reach them. As the film comes to a close, an astronaut from the International Space Station looks down at the planet and says, "This is the cleanest sky I've ever seen." Thanks for watching. Subscribe the channel for more interesting videos.